Buenos días, bienvenidos al IESE. Es para mí, I'm going to speak Spanish, but I understand that you will have translation. I'm sure that they will make it. And also you did some Spanish in your undergrad or something, right? So
2 years ago.
Good. Es un placer para mí darles a todos a todas la bienvenida a una nueva sesión de Energy Prospectives, una iniciativa que ya llega a su 13ª edición con el impulso, con la colaboración con Naturgy y la Fundación Naturgy, una actuación conjunta con el IESE para de manera regular que el sector energético se encuentre y podamos debatir con directivos empresarios de la industria, con los reguladores, con asociaciones de consumidores, los principales retos que tiene el sector mirando hacia el futuro. También, como ocurre en esta ocasión, con la presencia de personalidades del conjunto de la Unión Europea para que podamos analizar cuáles son las perspectivas de una regulación que cada vez es más de carácter europeo. Hoy contamos con dos personas de una gran trayectoria, de una gran proyección, de una gran profesionalidad. Las presento ya, son Cani Fernández, presidenta de la CNMC, una profesional de gran calibre, y Christian Zinglersen, si lo digo bien, que es director general de ACER, que es la agencia de cooperación de los reguladores de la energía en Europa. Su visión sobre la situación actual va a ser, yo creo, una gran aportación a este ciclo. Como sabemos, estamos en el momento de la transición energética. Ayer, Christian, cuando nos vimos, hablaba de una situación que a lo mejor los líderes europeos no son conscientes de su importancia. La comparaba con una reconstrucción tras una guerra, en el sentido del esfuerzo económico y del esfuerzo inversor que va a suponer. Bien, por mi parte, nada más, darles la bienvenida. Y agradecer naturalmente a la Fundación Naturgy y a Naturgy, tenemos aquí a sus presidentes, la colaboración con el IESE en esta iniciativa. Y sin más, le paso la palabra a Paco Reines para que nos dé unas palabras también de bienvenida.
Muy bien, muchas gracias, Jordi. Buenos días a todos, tanto los que están hoy aquí en esta aula del IESE como los más de 500 asistentes por conexión online, según me han informado, que habían acreditado su presencia hoy, ¿no? Primero, dar las gracias al IESE. 13 ediciones de unas conferencias tan técnicas, tan especializadas como son estas, demuestra que la iniciativa de la Fundación ya es un éxito y se ha consolidado. Y se ha consolidado, entre otras cosas, creo yo, por el rigor que aportan en temas tan importantes y tan de actualidad. Segundo, dar las gracias a los ponentes de hoy, a la señora Fernández y al señor Zinglersen, thank you very much, porque en sus apretadas agendas y el hecho de empezar un poquito más pronto de lo habitual es una demostración de sus apretadas agendas y del respeto que tienen tanto por la iniciativa de las Energy Prospectives como por su compromiso con esa transparencia que ya nos han dicho en más de una ocasión y que creo que es patente, las ganas de explicar en público lo que van haciendo en privado, ¿no? Yo creo que tener hoy aquí a la presidenta de la CNMC y al presidente de ACER para debatir temas regulatorios en el mundo de la energía, no solo es un privilegio, sino que es una gran oportunidad. No solamente por lo importante que es la transición energética en su conjunto y la necesidad de hacer una adecuada regulación durante este proceso de transición, sino también por la oportunidad que tiene el momento. Yo creo que después de lo acontecido desde el mes de marzo del 2022, si la energía era algo importante, se ha convertido en algo central. Yo creo que lo que yo he definido muchas veces en público, el trilema de la energía, es decir, el avanzar en la transición la transición energética, lo que alguien llama en términos coloquiales la transición verde, pero que es mucho más. El segundo es la garantía de suministro mientras tanto y que, por lo tanto, la transición no sea solamente un objetivo de punto de llegada, sino que exista un camino para lograrlo y que durante este camino no se ponga en riesgo la garantía de suministro. Y tercero, hacer que todo ese proceso se realice de una forma asequible para los ciudadanos, asequible para los consumidores, asequible para las empresas que requieren de la energía como motor único y eterno del movimiento. Desde Aristóteles ya el movimiento es el paso de la potencia al acto, según se define en la filosofía clásica. Bueno, pues la energía es la única que le permite realizar ese movimiento, ¿no? Entonces, el hecho de tener a los reguladores, yo creo que es para Naturgy, para el IESE y para la Fundación Naturgy un verdadero placer. ¿Por qué? Porque este mundo de la energía requiere de lo que yo siempre llamo smart regulation, porque nadie duda de que se tiene que regular. Para eso existen los reguladores, para evitar abusos, para distribuir las reglas de juego de una forma razonable y equitativa, pero nadie duda de que hay que ser realistas en esa regulación para permitir esa transición y que se cumplan los tres objetivos que decía antes, ¿no? Estoy seguro de que tanto uno como otro no van a escapar ningún tema, por lo que lo conozco a ambos, más obviamente a la señora Fernández. Son personas que argumentan y argumentan bien y que seguro que no escaparán ninguna de las preguntas que la audiencia les puedan hacer. Y por lo tanto yo ya les agradezco de antemano esa transparencia y esa sinceridad que necesitamos, no solo de ellos hoy, sino de los reguladores en el futuro, porque esto es un juego de doble entrada y de doble salida, en el cual pues esa colaboración en la gestión de la información, en la gestión de las expectativas y en buscar soluciones que cumplan con las condiciones de contorno de los problemas que tienen encima, va a ser fundamental para que la regulación no impida el desarrollo de lo que tiene que hacerse para conseguir los objetivos. Por lo tanto, yo no quito más minutos de introducción, porque creo que lo importante es escucharlos a ellas y después el poder preguntarles todo aquello que la audiencia crea conveniente. Gracias a todos por asistir, a los que están hoy en día aquí, a los que están conectados, y esperamos que, como ya he dicho, una vez consolidadas estas Energy Perspectives, la sesión de hoy vuelva a ser una de aquellas que recuerdan como haber aportado algo a este mundo nuestro, que es el de la energía. Gracias.
Como he dicho, tenemos un panel de lujo y le doy la palabra inicialmente a Cani Fernández y luego será Christian y luego abriremos el turno de debate.
Muy bien, pues muy buenos días a todos. Muchísimas gracias tanto a la Fundación Naturgy como al IESE. La verdad es que me hace ilusión volver a estas aulas que pisé hace un tiempo, o sea que para mí es un placer volver hoy aquí, así que muchísimas gracias a José Luis Suárez y a Francisco Reines, también a Rafael Villaseca, a Jordi Igual, a todos los que han estado preparando este acto y animándonos a venir a compartir con todos ustedes lo que son nuestro día a día, nuestro reto y nuestras perspectivas de futuro. Este es un evento que, como decía Paco Reines, se ha consolidado, es la 13ª edición, plantea debates de futuro, plantea momentos de reflexión y en este caso en concreto es un momento ideal para debatir sobre las condiciones económicas, técnicas, regulatorias que se perciben en el sector energético en este momento, pero ya hacia largo plazo. Y además es un privilegio también poder escuchar la visión de Christian Zinglersen sobre la situación y el futuro del sector. It is a pleasure to share with you our views in this very timely moment of market reforms and regulation from a regulatory perspective. En el mundo actual en el que nos estamos enfrentando a los desafíos que hemos vivido recientemente como consecuencia de una pandemia, una crisis económica, después una crisis de naturaleza militar, donde la energía ha sido, como decía Paco Reines, el centro de todas las preocupaciones de los reguladores, de las empresas, de los gobiernos, ese cambio climático que tenemos encima, la escasez de recursos ante lo que nos enfrentamos, la degradación del medio ambiente, requiere una actuación urgente y decidida desde todos los ámbitos. Y la transición hacia un sistema energético sostenible es ese reto que nos toca afrontar a todos, y hay que ver cómo hacerlo, de qué manera, contando con todo el mundo, y en particular los que tenemos responsabilidades en este sector, nos tenemos que hacer esas preguntas. De ahí el debate de hoy y su interés. Estamos desarrollando, es cierto, una conciencia cada vez mayor sobre la necesidad de adoptar tecnologías limpias y eficientes. A nivel global existe ya un compromiso claro y generalizado de reducción de las emisiones y de la promoción de fuentes de energía más limpias y sostenibles. Los acuerdos de París, que parecían una quimera hace tiempo, han calado y ya realmente están plasmándose en propias iniciativas y otras de ámbito internacional también, que ya establecen metas y objetivos concretos, ambiciosos sin duda, para limitar el calentamiento global y mitigar los impactos del cambio climático. Por lo tanto, estamos viviendo cambios profundos que no podríamos haber anticipado si no hubiera sido por los momentos tan decisivos que hemos vivido y que nos han hecho realmente avanzar pasos de gigante. Y tenemos ahora que afianzarlos para no tener un gigante con pies de barro. La transición energética es un reto, pero es verdad que también ofrece muchas oportunidades. Depende de nosotros que consigamos que esas oportunidades se hagan realidad. No solo podemos contribuir a la reducción de las emisiones y al cumplimiento de los objetivos climáticos, sino que también nos ofrece una gran oportunidad de impulsar la economía, promover la innovación y mejorar la calidad de vida de todas las personas. En el trilema energético al que se aludía antes el presidente de Naturgy, la realidad es que esa última pata del consumidor tiene que ser la que motive más nuestras actuaciones. A todo este reto se une el problema que hemos vivido de forma tan acuciante como es el de la seguridad de suministro. Es verdad que en España hubo en el primer momento de la crisis algunas voces de alarma que señalaban que podíamos enfrentarnos a un problema de suministro. La verdad es que ese nunca fue el reto de España. España tenía, desde esa perspectiva, bastante bien cubiertas sus necesidades. Sí que hubo un tema de shock de precios, pero sí que nos dimos cuenta todos de que, si bien en el trilema energético tenemos que enfocarnos hacia el consumidor, no podemos olvidar en ningún caso que la seguridad de suministro debe de ser una prioridad. Y así, tanto los gobiernos como la Comisión Europea acabaron apoyando las medidas de urgencia que, para paliar esa repercusión sobre la economía, los distintos gobiernos fueron aportando. Y, por supuesto, ACER estuvo muy vigilante para valorar esas medidas de urgencia y para asegurarnos de que fueran lo menos disruptoras posible de lo que son los principios fundamentales de mercado. Realmente el mercado tiene que seguir siendo lo que mande en nuestros en lo que es hoy en día el sector energético. Tenemos una situación en la que hemos vivido momentos difíciles, donde ha hecho falta medidas coyunturales, pero lo que no podemos dejar de lado es que ha sido precisamente el mercado el que ha conseguido consolidar lo que hoy en día tenemos dentro de lo que es la energía tal y como la vemos ahora. En estos momentos en el que tenemos un nuevo PNIEC que está en consulta pública, me permitirán que no me pronuncie porque represento un órgano colegiado que toma decisiones en consejo y por lo tanto será el consejo el que se pronuncie sobre él en su caso. La realidad es que vemos todos objetivos muy, muy ambiciosos en energías renovables. España tiene una posición muy privilegiada. No solamente tenemos un sistema gasista que es capaz de proporcionar esa seguridad de suministro que hemos visto tan necesaria durante estos dos últimos años, sino que además tenemos una posición privilegiada en materia de energías renovables. Pero tenemos muchos retos que afrontar, cómo integrar todas esas energías renovables en nuestro sistema energético, nuestro mix, cómo conseguir que se hagan una auténtica realidad. La regulación hoy debe abordar un montón de desafíos específicos asociados con esa integración de fuentes de energía renovables, que además son intermitentes, no tenemos esa seguridad. Desarrollar y modernizar nuestras infraestructuras energéticas para permitir, fundamentalmente mediante la digitalización, que esa intermitencia sea más controlable. y también esa garantía de suministro seguro y asequible, como comentaba también Paco Reines, asequible para los consumidores. Y en este conjunto de retos, la regulación desempeña un papel crucial, porque debe crear un marco normativo que posibilite la inversión, es decir, que proporcione garantías de certidumbre jurídica, pero que sea lo suficientemente flexible para que en situaciones en las que se produzcan esas disrupciones de mercado que hemos podido vivir, la adaptación sea posible, inmediata y además genere para los consumidores lo que tiene que generar, que es el acceso a una energía que sea asequible. Como autoridad reguladora independiente que es la CNMC, pues tenemos como función velar por la competencia, es nuestra función esencial, velar por que la competencia sea efectiva en los mercados y por supuesto en los mercados energéticos. Y en, en este momento de transición que estamos viviendo, ese papel es fundamental, porque muchas veces las preocupaciones esenciales por suministro, por precios, nos hacen olvidar que tenemos que mirar a medio y largo plazo y que es precisamente la competencia en los mercados la que nos va a garantizar que cuando las cosas se estabilizan realmente tenemos mercados sólidos y suficientemente fuertes como para funcionar en beneficio de los consumidores. Este es un sector, el de la energía, que ha sido objeto de transformaciones constantes y permanentes desde una perspectiva regulatoria. Es un sector que requiere de una especialización constante y permanente porque estos cambios normativos se han ido adaptando a cada nuevo desafío que hemos vivido. Como regulador nos estamos esforzando para llegar cada vez que hay un cambio normativo a ese difícil equilibrio entre la certidumbre jurídica de la que hablaba y la flexibilidad para adaptarse a los cambios, pero sin duda es esa certidumbre jurídica, ese marco regulatorio el que tiene que prevalecer precisamente para garantizar que tengamos las inversiones necesarias para ese marco de descarbonización al que queremos llegar. Los pilares de la regulación, que sea transparente, que sea proporcionada, que sea eficiente y ágil, son los que guían nuestro día a día. Intentamos hacerlo, a veces no lo conseguimos, pero ese es nuestro principal objetivo. Seguro que Christian coincide conmigo en que para poder llevar a cabo este tipo de marco regulatorio es crucial otorgar a los reguladores sectoriales independientes y por ende a ACER los poderes suficientes. Tenemos el conocimiento técnico, tenemos la visión de largo plazo, nuestros mandatos exceden los de cualquier legislatura y esa es la realidad, porque se pretende que los mercados también sean instrumentos que perduren en el tiempo, que tengamos una visión de largo plazo y esta es la finalidad que cumplen los reguladores independientes. Pero es fundamental dotarles de medios y es fundamental dejarles que se centren y se concentren en lo que es su tarea específica. Podemos ayudar en el refuerzo cuando hay medidas de urgencia, pero que eso no nos quite la posibilidad de seguir trabajando en lo que debemos trabajar, que es conseguir que los mercados sean mercados fuertes y que funcionen en plena competencia. Trabajamos todos de forma coordinada. ACER es nuestro paraguas. Es un muy buen foro para intercambiar experiencias, para afrontar de forma conjunta los retos a los que nos estamos enfrentando y para diseñar primero y después implementar de forma coordinada la normativa europea en materia de energía, que efectivamente es la que nos manda a todos, y esto es algo que no debemos olvidar. No es solo el regulador nacional no es nada más que una extensión de lo que es el regulador europeo. Este expertise técnico es lo que nos garantiza a todos que las decisiones que se adoptan en materia normativa sean lo menos erróneas posible, por decirlo de forma amable, porque en definitiva, desde que con el Real Decreto 1/2019 se nos otorgaron las competencias normativas, en la CNMC hemos estado desarrollando esa función, al principio con la precipitación requerida por los tiempos que teníamos en su momento. Abordaremos ahora el segundo periodo regulatorio y esperamos tener una visión, la necesaria visión de más largo plazo que a lo mejor no pudimos tener en el primer momento de las primeras circulares. Pero en todo caso, estoy convencida de que hemos desarrollado nuestras competencias con la mayor diligencia, con los plazos, los tiempos y los medios que teníamos, a través de decenas de circulares. Nuestras circulares abordan cuestiones de gran trascendencia como peajes, distribución o acceso de terceros a redes, que es siempre el punto de partida de una liberalización que funcione. Todo esto adquiere especial relevancia en escenarios de cambios muy rápidos como los que estamos viviendo ahora, y otra de las funciones que debemos cumplir es que en esos cambios rápidos que se tienen que adoptar en la legislación, en la normativa novedosa cada día, comentaba yo ayer en la cena que tuvimos que solamente en el año 2022 y solamente en materia de energía la CNMC ha asumido 24 nuevas funciones. En el ámbito de la energía, hubo otras en otros ámbitos que también regulamos, pero solamente en el ámbito de la energía. Y eso nos obliga a estar muy vigilantes para que en la aplicación de esas medidas de urgencia, además de nuestro día a día, no se vulneren derechos. La contribución de la CNMC, desde mi punto de vista, a todo lo que es el sector ha sido ágil, constante. Doy algunos ejemplos. La puesta en funcionamiento de un volumen sin precedentes de generación con renovables que ha requerido de una normativa de acceso y conexión apropiada, evolutiva, para poder superar las limitaciones de red y también para proporcionar un marco que permita resolver los conflictos entre promotores y operadores. Es decir, con un sistema de circular y al mismo tiempo resoluciones que nos ha permitido dotar de un marco original, previo y después una resolución del día a día. La conocida como regulación del tanque único europeo en el sector, perdón, del tanque único en el sector gasista, que se ha convertido en un referente europeo, es un ejemplo también de capacidad de innovación y de generación de oportunidades a las que creo, honestamente, que ha contribuido el regulador. Ha servido para aprovechar al máximo la capacidad de las infraestructuras españolas, que se han demostrado esenciales para garantizar también el suministro a nivel no solamente español, sino europeo. Y hemos incrementado además la competitividad del gas. La consecución de acuerdos de reparto de costes transfronterizos para el desarrollo de interconexiones que eliminen ese aislamiento histórico del sistema español. Son acuerdos que se negocian siguiendo la normativa europea, pero que tienen un grado de dificultad alto y que subrayan el empeño y la constancia en la consecución de los objetivos del regulador. El último de ellos, el de la interconexión del Golfo de Vizcaya. En los últimos meses estamos supervisando de forma específica las medidas adoptadas en el marco de la crisis energética, como son el mecanismo de minoración de la generación inframarginal eléctrica y el mecanismo de ajuste, el llamado mecanismo ibérico, que estarán en vigor hasta finales de año, y estamos además analizando su repercusión a corto y medio plazo. Hoy, en la CNMC, estamos centrados en colaborar con el resto de reguladores y con ACER, debatiendo sobre las propuestas de la Comisión Europea. Es un momento esencial de esa reforma. El Consejo, el Parlamento, con la propuesta de la Comisión, deberán debatir y fundamentalmente deberán abordar la reforma del mercado eléctrico europeo, la modificación del REMIT y el paquete del gas, fundamentalmente el hidrógeno. En estos momentos, además, estamos muy ocupados en dos circulares que son esenciales: acceso de la demanda, acceso de la generación. Estamos diseñando además la metodología de los peajes eléctricos y gasistas, porque el diseño de los incentivos en esta área va a ser un ejercicio muy complejo, pero muy determinante. Nos tiene que permitir integrar de forma masiva todos esos proyectos de renovables que en estos momentos existen en nuestro país, al mismo tiempo que nos dotamos de ese suministro seguro. La participación de la demanda. Esta es una asignatura pendiente, la que estamos abordando ahora mismo y que es fundamental. Salió a consulta pública, estamos con los grupos de trabajo y lo que pretendemos es adoptar una metodología lo suficientemente precisa y rigurosa para que fomente la eficiencia en el desarrollo de la actividad. Acceso y conexión a las redes es esencial, como decía, para garantizar la competencia en el sector energético y especialmente relevante para poder estandarizar y agilizar todos esos procesos, eliminando las barreras a la conexión de renovables. Los nuevos consumos eléctricos, como el vehículo eléctrico o como los centros de proceso de datos, los electrolizadores para la producción del hidrógeno, también van a requerir un desarrollo adicional que estamos diseñando en estos momentos para apoyar la rápida electrificación de la economía con una nueva circular adicional. Hace un mes que cerramos la consulta pública de la propuesta de circular de demanda. Hay un montón de novedades en esa circular. Esperamos haber acertado, pero en todo caso estamos estudiando las alegaciones de la consulta pública. Se contemplan los nuevos escenarios de acceso a la red de nuevas figuras, se maximiza el aprovechamiento de la capacidad de las redes y estamos haciendo un esfuerzo de mejora en la transparencia de los procedimientos. También estamos revisando la resolución de condiciones del acceso y conexión a las redes de transporte y distribución de energía eléctrica de la generación, con lo cual estamos viendo los dos aspectos de acceso a las redes que creemos nos darán una visión de conjunto muy necesaria. Promover la digitalización es otro de nuestros retos, automatizar las redes, participación de la demanda en proyectos pilotos, estamos con el sandbox regulatorio de control de tensión, todo ello para mejorar la eficacia operativa de las redes al menor coste posible, teniendo en cuenta que al final las redes las acabamos pagando entre todos. También hemos contribuido a la transición energética a través de nuestra función consultiva y de propuestas. Tenemos las propuestas, cualquier propuesta normativa requiere, en el ámbito de la energía va a requerir de nuestro informe de propuesta normativa. También estamos emitiendo los informes necesarios para las autorizaciones de instalaciones renovables para que los proyectos puedan cumplir con el requisito de la capacitación técnica y financiera, y en lo que va de año hemos emitido 300 informes sobre la capacidad legal, técnica y económica de los promotores de estas instalaciones. Al mismo tiempo también estamos adjudicando los conflictos de acceso y en lo que llevamos de año llaman más de 100. Este es un papel de árbitro que vamos a seguir ejerciendo y que es consustancial al hecho de que tenemos una red, tenemos que una única red a la que hay que dar acceso en definitiva. Voy a terminar ya. Lo único que voy a acabar diciendo es que es fundamental para nosotros esa colaboración a nivel europeo con ACER. Es la garantía de que los mercados funcionen y, de nuevo, como instrumento de generación de esas inversiones necesarias para la descarbonización, se ha demostrado el mejor instrumento. Los mercados deben funcionar. Si hace falta en momentos puntuales encontrar la solución a problemas puntuales, pues lo coyuntural debe ser coyuntural y lo estructural debe ser estructural. Y voy a dejarlo aquí para que Cristian nos dé su visión y luego quedo a su disposición para las preguntas que me quiera formular. Muchas gracias.
I'm going to give the floor now to Christian Zinglersen. It's a pleasure to have you with us. It's also, Christian is also an alumni of IESE, so it's good. You were in an AMP program a few years ago, so it's good to have you back. Solamente también quisiera añadir un recordatorio para toda la audiencia, tanto en la sala como online. Tendremos un turno de debate posteriormente. Creo que se va a pasar a recoger preguntas escritas, así yo podré administrar las preguntas de la sala junto con las preguntas que lleguen online o las que a mí se me ocurran con la interesante intervención de Cani y lo que nos va a contar ahora Cristian. O sea que si hay preguntas ya tenemos unas hojas a disposición para que serán distribuidas para que podáis hacerlas. Cristian, the floor is yours.
Thanks a lot, Jordi. Thank you, Cani, also for your remarks and your remarks about ACER as well. It's very nice to be back at IESE. I say that halfway because my AMP program was at the Barcelona campus. So I've actually never been to the Madrid campus, but I was promised a tour after this interaction with you also of the new building. So I look forward to that sort of being partly home as it were, even though I was in Barcelona at the time. I will pick up where Cani left off on similar subjects, but I will try to apply even more, let's say, the EU lens, which is sort of my day job, as it were. And I have four installments. I have a lot of slides, but I'll go through some of them quickly because I promised Manuel and Jordi to make it a roughly 25 minutes or something. That's like fine. That. But please, Joaquin, my colleague from ACER, he can testify. I like to speak a lot. So if you can help me sort of wrap it up, you know, I would appreciate it if you just give me a heads up. And you don't have to be too polite. I'm Danish. I don't take well to subtlety. You just have to say it directly. Okay. So I have four installments for you. A bit of the short term, somewhat focusing towards the end, towards the longer term. Longer term being, let's say, a little bit more unknown. And with some personal views of mine, which do not necessarily reflect ACER views. I'll start off with some recent learnings. These will be quite familiar to many of you. So I'll try to go through that relatively quickly and try to link that to what I think is top of mind of many, some of the current discussions ongoing in Brussels and in capitals on electricity market design. So I'll have a few examples of that, try to link that to some recent learnings, and maybe we can touch upon it in the subsequent Q&A. Then I'll move, maybe take a few cues from the market design discussions and try to draw out a couple of lessons that I see from this energy supply, actually this double energy supply shock that we have witnessed over the last 12, 18 months. Some lessons that I see could inform policymaking going forward. And I'll conclude with a somewhat more, let's say, broader exposé of some of the challenges that I see even further ahead. And those are personal views. So that's what's in store, and I'll try to get going so we get through it. And as said, I'll start with, let's see if I start with anything. What should I point it up to you, Rafa? Yeah, here we go. All right, good. Okay, so I'll start with some of the recent learnings. And one of them is this by now somewhat benign image of the roller coaster ride in electricity and gas prices that we've seen across Europe. This is taken from the TTF, so the Dutch gas hub and the German electricity exchange. And I think it's safe to say that price levels now, if you see the TTF, almost with no spreads across Europe, around 33, 34 euro per megawatt hour, it's in a societally acceptable range. Let me put it in those terms. It's not historic low. It is by no means historic high. Historic highs are seen there on the chart, but I would say we're down at a societally acceptable range, as it were. So that is a benign message, as it were. And looking ahead, we can see a movement on the forward markets, which I will call from red to blue to yellow, which basically shows that those who are putting forward futures contracts for delivery towards the end of 2024 also looks more benign. And it's possible to, let's say, have an acceptable price in hedging one's positions some years ahead. I'm not saying it's historically low, not at all, but I would argue that it's probably societally acceptable, as it were. And that, of course, reflects a supply and demand rebalancing at the end of the day. Prices are determined by supply and demand, give or take a few odd conundrums here and there. So there is a supply and demand rebalancing, which has been bumpy and also painful for some in the making. And you can see some of the main elements in that rebalancing here. Obviously, demand reduction has played a significant role. A huge shift towards LNG on the gas side has played a big role. I think we have more than 40% of gas coming to Europe now via LNG, which is a big change. And a number of other factors, including a significant uptake last year, also in renewable generation. And this rebalancing has happened amidst quite significant support efforts from governments. You see to the left sort of estimation of how much of GDP those support measures have entailed. That obviously raises a dilemma in and of its own self, because obviously different countries have different, let's say, fiscal balance sheet capabilities, as it were. But nevertheless, I think support measures in most countries was significant. And I think from an energy policy perspective, there have been some difficult balances to strike, not just in terms of whom to target, by how much, for how long, et cetera, classical issues, but also how to support in a way which does not take away every single incentive to reduce demand, because that demand reduction has actually been a very important part in this rebalancing of supply and demand that we have seen. So this is the conundrum, and I think we are all learning lessons on what worked really well and what worked less well, or counterproductively even, in terms of those support measures. And if I'm gonna do a bit of a promotion, we have a report coming out here at the end of July where we look at the roughly 439 different national measures, and we try to group them with some soft messaging around possible lessons that we can draw if something like this were to happen again in the future. Okay, turning a little bit back to gas and looking ahead, the outlook is significantly more benign. You'll probably be aware that gas stocks across Europe are quite high at the moment, almost at the very high end of the past 5-year average. That's very important because gas stocks are one of the primary flexibility providers in a cold winter season. So that, all things equal, makes that we are better set for a winter season coming. And on the pricing side, it probably also suggests the very significant price spikes we saw last summer, which were significantly driven by the need to emergency inject gas into storage, is going to be much less pronounced. It'll still happen, probably, but it'll be a much more smooth trajectory, and the likelihood that we'll see similar price spikes this summer, actually in a month or 6 or 8 weeks from now, is, let's just say, very low. It's a conservative formulation, I would say. I'd say it's very low. So that's good. Another reason why we can look a little bit further ahead with, let's say, more rosy outlook is on infrastructure, where this is perhaps the rest of Europe or parts of Europe catching up to where Spain has been for quite a while. There's significant new regasification capacity coming to European shores, particularly in northwestern Europe and also in the Baltic Sea basin. And what that basically suggests, it doesn't create more LNG supply in and of itself, but it reduces one bottleneck for the reception of LNG. And the fact that this is coming online in a record manner means actually that the price spreads between the different gas hubs in Europe is quite low at the moment, where if you go back, say, 9-12 months ago, there were very record high price spreads, showing that it was a very uneven capability to receive LNG from the outside. That is much less pronounced now. Another lesson from that, it's not strictly LNG specific. It is that when certain governments really put their minds to it, make build out of infrastructure an overriding public priority, invest massively in it, it can happen in record time. And that's maybe also a lesson to be thought about for the future, as it were. However, everything is not hunky-dory. We're not quite out of the woods yet. And one of the reasons for that is there is a relatively finite global LNG supply addition volumes coming, at least for the next 2 years, and then it will be ease up quite considerably. And that, of course, means that in a finite LNG supply environment, we will, by definition, be competing with other off-takers of LNG, including the big growth economies in Asia, not least China. And whilst China had a record low LNG demand last year, which was actually quite fortuitous for us because it freed up LNG volumes for us, it is not fully certain that something similar will happen this year. LNG demand in China is on the rise, albeit not as much as from a couple of years ago. So that's something to watch. And obviously in a tight environment, you'll know that if there's a significant outage anywhere on the planet, that can have a very significant impact on prices as well. This is the Freeport facility in the US, huge LNG facility. And it was interesting to note that once a big fire impacted Freeport, it had an immediate implication on prices in Europe. And when it came back online, it had an immediate, more fortuitous impact on prices across Europe. So just goes to show in a tight market, the unexpected can have, let's say, outsized impacts also on price developments. And of course, Freeport is far afield, but let's see what's happening in Europe, has happened over the last 12 months, the fact that a pipeline or a big significant gas facility can be, let's say, hit with something unexpected is perhaps less of a unrealistic scenario than we would have thought maybe a year ago. So it's something to watch, and we're not quite out of the woods yet. Turning to electricity then, here I think we're facing a bit of two things which are a bit on the upside. Maybe a little bit under-discussed, I think, last year was the fact that we were not facing just a gas supply crunch. We also saw an electricity supply crunch, at least across Europe in the aggregate. There was a very significant decrease in French nuclear production, which I think also had impact on Spain as a neighboring jurisdiction, but also on hydro production. So we actually had a double supply crunch. That was one of the reasons why, very counterintuitively perhaps, we saw a net increase in gas, in electricity generation from gas, despite record high gas prices. How on earth could that happen? Well, the only reason that can happen is you had nothing else to generate to meet the last units of demand. So, but this, the fortuitous picture is that this is turning a corner. We have more normal, situation coming back to the French nuclear fleet, somewhat more normal hydro output. We have significant increase in renewable output, and we still have a significant demand decrease. So on the electricity side, I think this is more of a benign picture. And then I'll close this first segment with a quick look at something which I find is quite significant. The really stellar new build, particularly of solar PV, during last year across Europe. And the point I will make on that is, I think that is significantly related to the high prices, because in a somewhat well-functioning market environment, if there are very significant high prices, you would expect those generation forms which have low lead time in build to come in very heavily. And that's exactly what happened. So that was a response in some ways to a high price environment, probably would have happened to a significant degree anyway, but I think this was an extra encouragement to build. And I think that will be a little bit my link to the next element on market design, because market design ideally should send some sort of price signal, so incentivize that, which can come in and rebalance supply and demand in a competitive and profit-making way. So I have a few slides on the current discussions in Brussels on electricity market design. And I'll start with something which for me is a little bit sort of the unifying feature or the unifying theme of those discussions, maybe a bit surprisingly, which is volatility and how one tackles volatility. I had deliberately chosen volatility for two reasons. One is I think volatility is on the rise. We will see in most jurisdictions in Europe much more fluctuating generation on the supply side, and we'll see a very significant increase in electrification of, let's say, demand sectors, which would also introduce more seasonal flexibility in, say, heating demand across many jurisdictions in Europe. So volatility is here to stay. That's the first reason. The other reason is I don't want to talk about addressing affordability or cost at that level, because I think fundamentally prices are a function of supply and demand. So a market design is not going to deliver in and of itself lower or higher or medium prices. That's a function of supply and demand, but it can put in place certain mechanisms which can influence supply and demand and also tackle volatility. So I'll use volatility as sort of a little bit the defining theme here. And I'll touch upon three here on the left-hand side, forward markets, longer-term contracting, and then the role of price signals so as to incentivize also flexibility. The reason why I touch upon that, I think one of the main elements of the electricity market design proposal from the Commission and the ensuing discussions is to look at how one can reduce volatility over the longer term by introducing more cost average pricing. There are several ways of doing that. You can hedge your position and have more average pricing. You can have a government contract come in and have more average pricing over time. Cost average pricing plus a profit premium, plus an insurance premium. And you can, let's say, facilitate or incentivize bilateral contracting via PPAs, et cetera. And I think that is one of the main elements that this reform, probably relatively light reform, seeks to achieve. Let's go to forward markets first. I think it's safe to say that in most jurisdictions across Europe, forward markets are not functioning as well as they could. Outside of Germany, it's difficult to find high levels of liquidity in the possibility to hedge your positions up to 3 years ahead. And I think there is a need to do something about it. And what this reform proposal introduces is to consider, not necessarily final decide on, but consider a merger of smaller hubs so as to pool liquidity in greater hubs. Technical. But what it basically suggests is it should... this reform should better the possibility for private players to come in and hedge their positions if they're worried about the volatility of their positions because they're short-term exposed. This often competes a little bit in political terms with the PPA market in terms of attention. There is a discussion in the context of this electricity market design reform, whether to nurture PPAs, facilitate PPAs more than today. Today, PPAs function quite well. I actually think Spain is a leader in the PPA market, as it were. It's probably also safe to say it's more of an option for bigger players, for more professional players. Why? It's bilateral contracting, it's relatively bespoke, and it's easier to handle counterparty risk if you are dealing with a big player whom you're fairly confident will remain in business over the next 5, 10, 15 years, the lifetime of the PPA. If you're trying to pool PPAs with much smaller suppliers, you will have, all things equal, an increased counterparty risk. And how do you shoulder that risk? Well, you need to standardize, et cetera, et cetera. So there are some at political level who see that broadening the approach to PPAs is a priority. Maybe standardizing PPAs is a priority. Maybe creating secondary markets as a function of that standardization is a priority, whereas others are skeptical of that. Why would you standardize something which is bespoke to private players' needs? Let me have my own thing. Go put your political attention to this thing, which is the forward markets. If you're looking for a standard product, go on exchange, buy it, and make that as liquid as possible, which would be our view. But anyway, that's the first part. Then we come to the government contracting. I love this cartoon. The devil is in the detail. The guy at the desk discovers once he gets to that that file, and this I think is true for government government underpinned long-term contracts, contract for differences. Contract for differences, a two-way contract for differences. You'll be familiar, will give a bit of a certainty in terms of a price floor. And if prices go relatively high, the government or that entity entrusted with administering the CFDs gets the profits. So win some, lose some, as it were, I guess you can say, in terms of CFDs. That obviously creates a significant price certainty type signal, making it ideally at least bankable. So what's not to like? Possibly a few things. Because one of the things, if one does a CFD, let's say in a suboptimal way, there is a risk that one can take away system responsiveness incentives. So if you're totally covered, irrespective of the particular short-term situation in the market, you may choose to do maintenance on your asset in a situation where there's scarcity in the market, and you would not want to incentivize that. So there is a need to create or maintain system responsiveness, even if one is under a CFD. And the other risk is that you risk perhaps diluting the forward market if you do it wrong, because if more and more, maybe potentially in the end, everyone is on a government type guarantee, why would you go to the forward market to hedge your risk? Because you don't have any risk. So why would you do that? And that could also be, let's say, an inadvertent outcome. So what we, ACER with NRAs, have tried to coin, we thought it was an ingenious expression, we tried to coin smart CFDs. So we're advocating smart CFDs as an outcome of the discussions on electricity market design, probably informed a bit by guidance so as to avoid these, what we would say, are hopefully inadvertent outcomes, as it were. The final thing I wanted to mention is on flexibility. We can probably all agree that flexibility is not only here to stay, it's likely, or flexibility needs not only here to stay, but it's likely to increase in line with more intermittent generation and more electrification of demand, and therefore also more, let's say, seasonal flexibility introduced in the demand side. There are a lot of discussions about how to, let's say, facilitate greater flexibility needs. Some of them concerns the broader regulatory framework. There are discussions about, in some jurisdictions, that may need support to get flexibility needs going. That's maybe not relevant for all jurisdictions, but might be relevant for some. And then therefore, of course, there are discussions about what is national level, what is EU level. Many flexibility or balancing type needs will be done at the local level, maybe not even at the national level, some will. So what's the need for the EU level? And we can discuss that maybe afterwards or in the break bilaterally. But those are the type of discussions that we're having and we're also weighing in on. A volunteer and experience I had recently in Copenhagen. I was part of the inaugural event of a new forum set up in my home country of Denmark, which was called the Forum for Flexibility. So they meet once or twice a year. It's a big stakeholder type forum looking at how we can nurture flexibility, demand side response, et cetera, et cetera. And some of the takeaway, I mentioned that last night at the dinner we had, the takeaway, put a little bit bluntly and paraphrasing, was, look, folks, technology innovation moves very fast. Business innovation moves very fast. Regulatory frameworks move very slow. So your best contribution here is to get out of the way. It wasn't exactly like that, but this was the gist of it. And I think there is a point there. Not in getting out of the way, but of course, having the appropriate regulatory frameworks so we're not in the way. And one of the things I think we need to do as a regulatory community is to zoom in laser-like on the barriers against demand-side flexibility. I find that many decision makers are super interested, maybe also fond of, all these new, shiny, fantastic, innovative things which are flexible. Maybe they're flexibility on wheels, called an EV. Maybe they're big battery facilities. Maybe they're the techie new stuff. All great. Let's cut a lot of ribbons on that. But that which can sometimes be a barrier to the uptake of it is much more around social policy and cushioning and protecting, et cetera, which is difficult to tackle once put in place. All the more reason to zoom in on, at least in terms of identification, what those barriers are. And that's what we seek to do at ACER, where we have every other year, sort of quite comprehensive, what we call a barriers report. The second installment is coming out here in the fall on that one. So that thing is very important. Now, that's a segue from this, okay, so brief overview of the electricity market design discussions. There are many other things that could be said, and maybe we'll touch upon it in the Q&A. But I'll use this as a segue to looking a bit further ahead. And I'll use this, this segue to maybe mention a couple of insights that I see from this double supply shock that we've seen over the last, let's say, 12, 18 months or so. And I'll start with this image, which I really like. I always like to use this cartoon. It's a funny cartoon, you know, it gets the mind going and all that, and super cute. And of course, as any useful cartoon, behind the nice image, there is an important message lingering. And the message I would point to here is there's a need to balance and to look at balance and not to be, overtaken by those who are messaging the need not to balance. And how to put that a little bit into more, layman-type terms. I think one of the lessons from the past 12 or 18 months to me is the risk in having an overly strong focus on the supply side. This is something which the International Monetary Fund, and to some extent International Energy Agency, also are looking at from a monetary policy or more of an energy policy type perspective. Maybe the best bumper sticker example of overly over-focus on the supply side is, let's say, the more aggressive NGO community who advocate keep it in the ground. Keep fossil fuels in the ground. That can be a very laudable thing to keep it in the ground. However, that needs to be accompanied by aggressive demand reduction, targeting the structural demand drivers of that which you wish to restrict. Because if you don't do that, you keep something in the ground, proverbially speaking, you restrict supply, and you face inelastic demand, what's going to happen? Yes, a quintessential economic institution, you'll have prices going north. And politicians will, of course, react. As they should. So if one wants to supply side restrict, one will need to aggressively target the structural demand drivers of that which you wish to restrict. Those things need to go hand in hand. This is one of the reasons why I think central banks are actually investing significantly more in energy analytics, and energy policy, and energy market monitoring, because they see this transition trajectory ahead as potentially volatile and bumpy, with these types of, let's say, impacts, which will affect their monetary policy decisions. One of the reasons why we have more to do with central banks than we had two or three years ago, as ACER, I mean. So for policymakers as such, what I think it also implies is a mix of being on it in terms of market developments, but also keeping a fair level of pragmatism in terms of how one does policymaking. And I would say what it means for the next 5, 10, 15 years, probably also with some knock-on implications for us in the regulatory community, is we need to have very rigorous market monitoring, and we need to encourage policymakers to course correct regularly, to be willing and capable to course correct, because we're facing a bumpy and volatile ride ahead, I think. At least that's my prediction. Then coming a little bit back to this figure, which I showed before, I'll touch upon another lesson from my perspective, again, with an EU lens, perhaps, maybe I'm a bit biased here, in terms of tackling volatility. And one means of that is to strengthen EU market integration. On the right, you'll see what I would call, actually from the NEMOs, helped us out with this, let's say, bumper sticker type calculation, rough estimate for 2021, which was a simulation of what was the volatility reduction effect of having connected markets as opposed to having very isolated markets. And the rough calculation was a 7-fold decrease in volatility just by virtue of having that. Then there are other benefits in terms of trade, et cetera, but in terms of volatility dampening effect, this is super significant if you'll accept that we are likely to move into a trajectory which will be more rather than less volatile over the next 5, 10, 15 years, given the energy transition trajectory ahead. In addition to volatility per se, we can also, I think, safely say, with the benefit of hindsight, that there's huge security of supply benefits in a more integrated markets. Let's take your neighboring country, France, as an example. France had an unprecedented problem with outage in their French nuclear fleet, which is actually a very sizable share of the overall nuclear fleet in Europe, and went from the structural net electricity exporter par excellence, dare I say, in Europe, to a huge net importer. And just that swing from exporter to importer from France was the equivalent of the electricity demand of Belgium. That was a swing. and it worked. To my knowledge, there were no scarcity-induced blackouts in France. A lot of that was provided by the infrastructure in place and, of course, by the market rules between the different electricity markets in Europe. So that was, from the perspective of France, a huge security of supply enhancer, as indeed for gas it has been for Germany or for Austria or Central and Eastern Europe countries who were very, very reliant, way much too reliant, on Russian gas for their gas needs. And that brings me to the final slide in this segment. And then I have one final one and I'll close. You may say then, in terms of this electricity back and forth, that's all great for the net importers, right? Of course, they are dependent on imports for their needs, et cetera. But what about us who are net exporters? That surely doesn't apply, doesn't it? Actually, it does. Very many of those who are net exporters in the aggregate volumes, they're actually significantly reliant on imports during a fair, sizable share of hours during the course of a year. Another way to put that is we're sort of in it together in terms of electricity flows, some more than others. And this notion about whether you are in the net aggregate importer or exporter is perhaps not so significant. There is an interdependence in play and it's real. So for that, I would conclude then from this part that in terms of volatility, enhanced resilience, cost efficiency benefits, there is very significant value in strengthened EU energy market integration. And I'll use that a bit to link to my final group of slides, which are some of these broader challenges ahead exactly for that, as I see it. And again, admittedly, this is with an EU lens. You may find it's a little bit too EU-ish for your liking, but hey, that's my job. So we can discuss how relevant it is in a Spanish context in a second once I close. So these are some of the wider challenges I see going forward, and these are my personal views. The point of departure here for me are some of the main initiatives, declarations launched or signed at political level, actually very often at the highest levels of government across Europe over the last couple of years, I would say. And these are some of the visions or statements which speak to regional energy hubs of huge utility scale, basically implying a energy hub of a regional or even a continental wide nature, exporting energy volumes, whether the molecular or electricity across the continent. And maybe that even goes beyond, let's say, the usual suspects, because there is emerging analysis, also government interest in certain quarters for having that, let's say, in Central Eastern Europe as well, those types of models, perhaps. Some countries are more interested in that than others, and also drawing in the landlocked states, not in the Mediterranean basin or in the North Sea or the Baltic Sea basin. Now, of course, there are some sound economic and energy technical reasons for these types of visions. Basically, they revolve around notions of trade and reaping the relative resource endowments at scale, which we know from trade economics and so forth. The reasons, as we spoke of, related to efficiency, to enhanced resilience, to cost efficiency, and therefore also affordability. And obviously in a context of a very aggressive energy transition, which will likely entail the most ambitious industrial transformation of Europe since the Second World War, you would think that would be costly. So you would want to draw on most of the available affordability levers that you have. And this obviously is one. However, doing the math, as I call it, is one thing. Squaring the politics or aligning the politics is something completely different. And that, for me, is probably the primordial challenge as I see it going forward, again, from an EU lens. I'm not saying this is the key challenge necessarily at national level in every single aspect, but at the, from the EU perspective, in my personal view, in terms of energy market integration, what we do forward, this is the key challenge ahead. Are we able to sort of utilize our EU model to leverage these benefits, reap these relative resource endowments at scale, or are we not? Because if we go in this direction, obviously, some will become structural exporters, and by definition, some will become more structural importers. It's difficult for everyone to become a structural exporter at the same time, obviously. And it introduces a very significant degree of interdependence, both on the exporter side and on the importer side, again, with good economic sound principles behind them. However, much politics still remains relatively national. And so there is a need probably to invest also politically, so to speak, in whether that level of mutual reliance and interdependence is acceptable. Are the control levers, are they sufficiently developed in order for that to be a viable political proposition? And it also comes with certain implications, and I'll just mention a few of them and then I'll close. And that will be, I think, part of these discussions, which I think will happen in the next 2, 3, 4, 5 years across the EU. And one of the implications is, of course, the approach to markets. Because this type of hub-based regional hubs serving the region or even the continent will have knock-on implications for market functioning. Markets will need to flow relatively freely for so many jurisdictions to be comfortable with this type of model. So in the absence of that, I think it's unlikely to materialize. I think it'll have implications significantly for system operation, a bit of a technical term, perhaps. I think system operation needs to become much more regionally optimized as opposed to nationally optimized compared to what it is today. And by way of example, we do a yearly report, monitoring report on the so-called 70% target, which is a technical title if ever I saw one. What it basically looks at is how much capacity of interconnections is made available for trade and how much is held back. And we are not doing well across Europe. We're actually not even improving very much. And so maybe by next year, if that doesn't change, I think we'll need to sound a bit of a code red here. If we're not putting capacity for cross-zonal trade to the market, why would you rely on increased interconnection? And how can you have these regional hubs? It does not compute. So we'll need to have a significantly more regionally optimized way of operating the system. And I'll close with this as a third and final example of implications as I see it. Maybe it's a bit broader, maybe it's a bit more fluffy. I think it'll have implications for how we assess broader system needs. It's a bit of a messy slide. We have a new construct called the Scientific Advisory Board for Climate Change across the EU, which basically points to our current infrastructure planning model aggregated at the EU level for not being fit for energy transition purpose. We have the utility's own interest organization, Euroelectric. I'm assuming Naturgy is probably a member of it. Some of the big Spanish players are certainly very active members of Euroelectric, which in the market design paper coming out a few months ago this spring, basically points to all these massive investments undertaken at the national and aggregate EU level are not coordinated in the right way. Not planned, it's not Soviet Union 2.0, but you know, not coordinated in the right way. And I think also when we look at adequacy and how that is being tackled across different jurisdictions and how different jurisdictions factor in cross-border contributions, that's also relatively uneven. And this also brings up inevitable issues about what's done at national level, what's done at EU level. Is the system needs national level, of course. Is it also EU level? Maybe not. To what degree? How is it underpinned, et cetera? So there are some implications for moving in this more regional hub, Mediterranean basin, North Sea, Baltic Sea basin type direction, also for how we assess system needs. So all in all, what I would say by way of summary and conclusion is, I think there are significant opportunities ahead to leverage what we have. We've managed to stay together, roughly speaking, as a European Union during the toughest of times. Not many export controls were put in place, which would have been the kiss of death for energy market integration efforts. That did not happen to any large or detectable degree, despite the massive double supply shock. There are a lot of sound economic principles underpinning this enhanced energy market integration process ahead. Politics remain, in my view, surprisingly national when it comes to some of these things. And the need to invest also politically in this type of future, if one were to find this desirable, would probably need to pick up, because I think currently it's somewhat under-acknowledged, under-articulated, and under-invested in. So we'll see whether that changes in the coming years, depending, of course, on the different political preferences at play in Europe. I'll conclude with that. Thanks a lot.
Thanks very much, Christian. That was an excellent overview of the policy challenges of the European Union regarding energy policy. Tenemos 25 minutos. Tenemos que terminar exactamente a las 10, porque todos tenemos un día seguro muy ocupados. Y tenemos aproximadamente 5 o 6 preguntas que he agrupado de la sala. Hay una pregunta que gana por goleada y por tanto va a ser la primera que voy a plantear a los panelistas. Y como digo, hay 5 o 6, o sea que tendríamos que intentar cubrirlas todas. Pero la primera, tal vez es por la cantidad, por el interés, es la más importante. La primera tiene que ver con la reforma del mercado y los mercados de capacidad, ¿no? Un asunto que, por lo que veo, preocupa mucho al sector, ¿no? Se pregunta cuál es el punto de vista de los ponentes sobre los mercados de capacidad y sobre la propuesta de minoración de ingresos de las plantas inframarginales. Se pregunta por la capacidad de que exista a nivel europeo un único mercado único de capacidad con incentivos similares en toda Europa, ¿no? Esta es un poco la primera pregunta. No sé, Cani, ¿empiezas tú? Así descansa un poco, Christian.
Bueno, es curioso que esta sea la primera pregunta porque ayer estuvimos debatiendo sobre este tema y la pregunta se puede plantear desde muchas perspectivas, pero si empezamos planteándonos que un mecanismo de capacidad tiene una finalidad precisamente de asegurar el suministro y eso pues, tiene un coste y por lo tanto un precio, tendremos que diseñar algún tipo de mecanismo que permita contar con esa seguridad de alguna manera, ¿no? Y aquí todo el debate fundamentalmente tiene que ver con hasta qué punto esto se puede considerar que es una ayuda de Estado o no es una ayuda de Estado. Bueno, el debate no es nuevo. La realidad es que en un país como el que tenemos nosotros con un potencial de renovables tan impresionante y por lo tanto con interrumpibilidad y con una necesidad de gestionar esa energía renovable, los mecanismos de capacidad pueden ser un elemento necesario de los mercados. La cuestión es ver cómo se diseñan, cuál es el diseño más adecuado para que esos mecanismos de capacidad tengan realmente esa función y no vayan más allá. Pero a mí se me antoja muy difícil cómo abordar la transición energética sin tener mecanismos que nos aseguren que vamos a tener esa gestionabilidad necesaria. Paso la palabra a Christian.
Christian, what do you think?
I think it's a tough issue because I think capacity mechanisms have gotten a bit of a bad rap in certain quarters because they were used to subsidize incumbents to the detriment of new players, and therefore in some jurisdictions probably played a role in terms of a barrier to entry for new players. That of course should not be the whole discussion because we need to look ahead, and as you rightly said, energy transition is happening very fast and new needs are emerging. So I think there is definitely a place in certain quarters for remuneration of capacity where there is that adequacy need, where that is assessed. I still think it makes sense to have regulatory scrutiny over that proposition, because it's a societal element and there are those who could, let's say, be at jeopardy if it's overused, as it were. Not only the cost is higher, but there's also a competitive impact of it. Maybe less so if it's in the form of what we call strategic reserves, which are off market. And it's basically a payment to come into the market if and when the situation arises, as opposed to a base payment for those that are already in the market, which I think is significantly more serious. And therefore warrants greater scrutiny, in my view. Is it possible to have a single market for capacity across Europe? I would be skeptical to that in the near term. I do think it's important to be open to cross-border contributions for capacity markets because they, one, could make them cheaper if they serve the same purpose, if one has confidence in those supplies being available across border. If not, then that's not a viable proposition. And secondly, because I think that can actually be an incentive for innovation. One thing which relates a bit to capacity markets longer term, which for me is really the holy grail, the big conundrum, the million-dollar question, et cetera, is what is going to provide a seasonal swing flexibility? So the big swings in seasons. I'm not particularly worried, to be honest, about flexibility needs in the hour, in the day, maybe 2 days. I think with business innovation, technology innovation, the digital interface, that will be solvable. But the 6, 8,
12-week seasonality swings. That I don't know whether we have figured out quite yet in the absence of gas, because today a lot of that is actually provided by gas. It's molecularly superbly designed to do so. So one could imagine hydrogen picking that up, but with conversion rates for electrolysis, that would be an expensive proposition. So that whether that's a capacity market or something standalone, I think we'll need to discuss over the, it's not right now urgent we need to have it, but in 5-10 years, we need to have a solid response to that. Maybe sooner.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say, 10 years would be too long, you know, to solve this problem, I guess.
Muy bien. Hay una segunda pregunta que combino dos intervenciones. Por un lado, uno de los asistentes dice que, bueno, tal vez habría que hacer una toma de razón de que el crecimiento de la generación eléctrica vendrá por tecnologías de coste fijo, renovables, nuclear, ¿no? Y otra pregunta interviene en algo que está muy candente, que está relacionado, es que, bueno, estamos llegando a una situación en la cual probablemente las inversiones en renovables están siendo tan elevadas que los precios pueden acabar en negativo en el corto plazo, con lo cual se plantea una cuestión de hasta qué punto se pueden dar garantías o se va a detener la inversión en renovables si no se ve un horizonte claro de su rentabilidad, ¿no? O sea, que esta es la segunda pregunta que os hago.
Because it didn't come through. Is it negative prices and low marginal costs?
I mean, the idea is that you have most of the new generation capacity is going to be a fixed cost base. And we know this type of industries, you have lump sum capacity being installed, extra supply, prices drop, and then, there's too much investment. How do you handle that? What do you think regulators should be doing in terms of handling that?
Yep.
Who starts?
You can start.
Christian, you want to start with this one?
Yeah. Yep. Okay. So a lot of new generation will be high capex, very low opex, dominated type technologies, and that puts a premium on visibility of revenue, because that's what adds to the financeability of those types of projects. Yes. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the relatively moderate / soft touch in the electricity market design proposal is to further facilitate long-term revenue visibility via, let's say, encouraging long-term contracting, because long-term contracting, whether you hedge, or you have a government contract, bilateral contract, you have more cost average pricing plus an insurance premium and a profit premium. So I think that is in line with the electricity market design discussion. The second part of the question, as I understood it, already was, okay, so now what? Now what about in the operations and the price impacts of low marginal cost generation? This is a tricky one. I don't buy for a second, to be honest, the proposition that a saturated low marginal cost environment does away with supply demand pricing. But it comes with some prerequisites. And what we're seeing in Northwestern Europe now, we're seeing massive negative prices in jurisdictions where there is quite low demand right now and huge influx of particular solar PV. And that may also be the case in Spain or may come to Spain, probably will come to many other jurisdictions. If it comes to the Netherlands, I suspect it will come to Spain, which probably has slightly higher attractiveness of solar radiance levels than the Dutch do. So what gives there? One of the things I think really needs to give is one needs to be quite sure as to what is pushing these generation volumes. Is this government money? Is it government contracting pushing these volumes into the market? Or is it drawn by demand or anticipated demand? I would hope it's the second. What about the regulatory framework for these assets? How system responsive is that framework? Because why are you keeping producing in negative prices or zero prices? And it comes back to this issue of regulatory frameworks about facilitating demand side response. You can make a killing at minus 500 euros per megawatt hour if you suck up and absorb electricity. So why is it not happening to that significant degree? I suspect it's because there's still a lot of barriers in those jurisdictions or lack of system responsiveness. A third element, which would need to be part of that pricing structure, is a proper tariffication. You need to have a locational element in your tariff structure, so you incentivize the placement of assets where the system value is the highest. And some jurisdictions, frankly, don't have that. So, but these are prerequisites. If you do away with them, you sort of say, no. Yeah, of course you're in for a problem, because you're basically putting a societally incentivizing model under something which does not really meet demand to the proper extent in the right locations at the right time. So then what do you do? Do you let the merchant fleet suffer because they made the investment? Or if you were pushing it very heavily, well, then you sit with it because you took on the risk. Something there needs to, that's part of a broader discussion, I think, coming. So I won't give up on the pricing structure, not just yet, but it does come with prerequisites. Some things need to be done in a different manner, otherwise you're stuck with a problem. That I would admit, absolutely. It's a long answer.
Yo, bueno, por mi parte, añadir también que afortunadamente estamos desarrollando los proyectos de hidrógeno en paralelo, porque es cierto que el hidrógeno lo podremos desarrollar cuando tengamos suficientes renovables para lo que es el consumo de consumidores directos, ¿no? Por lo tanto, yo creo que es pronto todavía para sacar una conclusión directa de que estemos sobreinvirtiendo en tecnologías renovables, diría. Entonces, que es un poquito pronto.
Ok, muchas gracias. Yo creo que es...
Jordi, ¿puedo venir con una cosa?
Sure, sure. I want to have time for the other three questions, but it's time.
Okay. I wanted to bring a reflection from my own past in the Danish government, where I was responsible for energy policy for a little while. This is some years ago, and I don't know if it applies to your environment, but I found it instructive at the time. I found there were quite a number of private players who were advocating for strong deployment targets of certain technologies and pushing the political level for that. This was my assessment at the time. And when I had discussions with them, I said, okay, fine. But then if these things materialize and they're driven by political targets, are you going to guarantee me that some years later, you're not going to come and complain about the curtailment of some of these volumes and make that the government's problem too? Because two wrongs, frankly, don't make a right. And I think, I'm not saying we have this in our, at all, but if we extrapolate from that 5 years ahead, 10 years ahead, 15 years ahead, something's got to give. And very rarely in my experience has two wrongs, quote unquote, made a right. Also in terms of a successful lobbying strategy. What comes around goes around eventually. So there we need to be careful. And I also say that to private players. One needs to be a bit careful about how one pushes one's interests.
Muy bien. Yo esto puede dar para más, pero de momento voy a pasar a otra pregunta para un dominio también relacionado, ¿no? Hay una pregunta sobre generación distribuida, que puede ser de solar o puede ser de hidrógeno. La pregunta es de hidrógeno y acceso a las redes, ¿no? Y hasta qué punto esto va a ser posible. Me parece que es una pregunta muy relevante que enlaza un poco con la anterior. Y además esta pregunta en el fondo enlaza con el trilema de lo que, del que nos hablaba Paco Reinés. Porque claro, aquí queremos tener una transición verde asequible con seguridad de suministro y también con unos activos heredados que si entra mucha capacidad nueva van a quedar stranded, ¿no? Entonces, ¿cómo resolvemos esto? La generación distribuida.
Bueno, en el ámbito, porque la pregunta estaba relacionada con el hidrógeno. Afortunadamente estamos con los biogases, con biometano, como un sandbox que nos está permitiendo ver si realmente puede funcionar o no, si las infraestructuras que tenemos son suficientes o deben ser modificadas, y vamos a tener la posibilidad de ir viéndolo como un caso de estudio, ¿no? Y es fundamental sobre todo por el potencial de biometano que tenemos en España con todo el sector agrícola. En cuanto a la generación distribuida, bueno, precisamente estamos, la flexibilidad va a ser una de las soluciones a ese trilema, no me cabe duda, y por lo tanto tenemos que estar empezando ya, de hecho estamos empezando ya a intentar resolver ese problema, empezando con todo lo que es la regulación de los accesos, ¿no? Pero bueno, yo creo que las perspectivas de momento son halagüeñas. Estamos dando los pasos que creo que se deben de dar para poder incorporar los nuevos gases renovables de forma lo suficientemente prudente, ¿no? creo que es como hay que hacerlo.
Christian, you want to add on this?
Yeah, I'll try to be brief on this one to save time. So I think what I would point to, we'll see a mass increase in distributed generation, of course. What needs to be, what needs to happen is to have the right locational signals in terms of placement and tariffication. So where there is the higher system value, there needs to be a more fortuitous tariff signal. And I think we have to be very careful with net metering type practices, which can, I think, basically constitute an indirect subsidy and therefore lead to something which will come and bite us in the tail afterwards. I had that experience in my home country, and yeah, that had a number of repercussions, both for the repercussions, mm-hmm. both on the private side, both on the political side. So those are the two things I would point to in terms of things to watch.
Muy bien. El cuarto tema que aparece tiene que ver con la inversión en redes. Hay un participante que cree que la inversión en redes está un poco olvidada, que además, aunque sea costoso, habría que crear por seguridad un excedente en redes. ¿Cuál es vuestra opinión sobre esta cuestión?
Por seguridad, un excedente en redes. A ver, nosotros precisamente lo que tratamos es de que la remuneración que se dé a esas redes sea lo más eficiente posible en términos de precio, porque al final es el consumidor el que acaba pagando esas redes, ¿no? Y por lo tanto tenemos una derivación probablemente hacia ser muy restrictivos, porque no nos queda otra, porque en definitiva lo que no queremos es que haya sobreinversión. Eso es realmente un, entiendo que es un problema que puede tener un efecto circular, ¿no? Si no invertimos suficientemente en redes, entonces no damos suficiente acceso, etc. La realidad es que tenemos que ir acompasándolo y tenemos que tener una visión real de qué es lo que tenemos en el mercado, qué es lo que tiene que entrar en las redes para poder tomar esa decisión de inversión, y no al revés. Uh-huh. No podemos tomar primero la decisión de inversión en redes y luego ver qué es lo que tenemos en el mercado, porque al final lo acabamos pagando todos. Se trata de que al final, si al final resulta que el concepto de peaje se nos va a volver a disparar como antes de la crisis, vamos a tener que adoptar pues hábitos de consumo nuevos y tal, pues ya llegaremos allí, pero primero hay que evitar el problema, y el problema es que no haya una sobreinversión, y más teniendo en cuenta, como estamos hablando, de que en renovables podemos acabar teniendo muy pronto precios negativos, que a lo mejor esa sobreinversión en redes no nos va a generar después energía suficientemente eficiente en términos de precio, con lo cual yo creo que tenemos que acompasar esa necesidad de inversión de redes con los datos reales de lo que es la generación potencial y la demanda potencial. Esta es la perspectiva del regulador, que tiene que determinar la retribución de esas redes, básicamente. En fin.
Christian.
Yeah, I think there is a challenge in Europe in terms of having grid infrastructure, also transmission grid infrastructure, keep up. There's quite significant delays in parts of Europe, and a significant share of those delays can be attributed to permitting delays, not necessarily regulators' thumbs up or thumbs down, but permitting delays. There's an agreement at the EU level to try to tackle that and reduce permitting delays to a certain limit, et cetera, what's acceptable. I think that is pertinent. When it comes to the regulatory frameworks, I agree with Cani, there is a tricky balance to be struck here, because at the end of the day, of course, it's the consumers who pay for the network infrastructure. Probably there is a need to take on slightly more risk, I think, the regulator side than in the past, because we're not in an incremental status quo environment. We're in an aggressive deployment type environment with the transition pathway outlined at political level, but it can't be unlimited risk. It needs to be smart risk, as it were. And I think one absolute no regret is to introduce appropriate locational elements in tariffication, so that you get things connected at the most, let's say, system valuable locations. I think early on there was like a connect and forget type approach, right? You come with a project, oh, is it renewable or is it technology X? Connect whatsoever. I think those days are over. There needs to be a locational element in terms of grid connection tariffs, which need to be cost reflective, as it were. Otherwise, again, we are creating problems for ourselves, which we'll need to solve later on.
Si puedo añadir algo, porque este es un punto en el cual las inversiones proyectadas deben ejecutarse lo antes posible. Cuando hablamos de interconexiones, la perspectiva cambia un poco, porque ahí sí que vamos a hablar de eso.
Sí. Vale, pues entonces... La última pregunta.
Muy bien.
La última pregunta que ha llegado online y que además enlaza con una que yo le quería hacer a los ponentes, especialmente en este caso a Christian, porque ha hecho mucho énfasis y porque su oficio es estar en la Unión Europea tratando de que se genere un mercado único, permitiendo mayores interconexiones, ¿no? Una pregunta online dice, ACER has just made a very compelling case for better integration using France. What can ACER do to ensure that EU interconnections are met and between Iberia and the European Union? Yo simpatizo enormemente con la visión de ACER y de Christian sobre las ventajas del libre comercio, que como puedes, no puede ser de otro modo. Los economistas lo tendemos a ver como beneficioso. Todo el mundo, es decir, en agregado salimos ganando del libre comercio, pero la economía política del comercio es otra cosa. El comercio crea ganadores y perdedores. Y sospecho que si no hemos visto más interconexión a lo largo de los años es precisamente por esto. What are the prospects? Cani, ¿quieres empezar tú? Que te he cortado con la interconexión.
No, simplemente iba a hacer una llamada para... De hecho, iba a pedir ayuda a la propia Comisión Europea y a ACER para que impulsen todas las interconexiones que tenemos planificadas, porque la realidad, y creo que en estos momentos Francia estaría de acuerdo, es que durante todo el problema de mantenimiento de las centrales nucleares francesas hemos sido exportadores netos y se nos critica por haber consumido más gas del necesario por el mecanismo ibérico, pero no hay que olvidar que gran parte de ese consumo ha ido a exportar precisamente energía a Francia en momentos de debilidad del sistema francés, lo cual demuestra el hecho de que seamos nosotros una isla energética no es un beneficio para Europa, sino todo lo contrario. Entonces, lo que quería era pedir ayuda para que las interconexiones de verdad se ejecuten. Y cuando no se ejecuten, pues quizá un procedimiento de infracción podría ser una solución.
Very good.
We end on a high note, don't we? Christian. Yeah. 2 minutes.
2 minutes, okay. I agree this needs this broader issue of interconnection, not necessarily bilaterally Spain, France only, but broader issue needs more attention and probably it needs a bit more stick.
More?
Stick.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We don't have that stick. That's a treaty infringement stick that resides elsewhere. Yeah. We do have a role once projects are at advanced stage of negotiations, so not necessarily the target, but advanced stage of negotiations, if there is a disagreement on who pays and who pays what. If there's that disagreement, we can come in and help, let's say, facilitate those discussions, which are a bit zero sum, so it's not an ideal role, but it's a relevant one. So I won't overplay our significance for the big picture, but we do have views and we want to make them heard, but we don't have the stick. There is a secondary element, which is super important. This is the 70% target fluffy stuff I talked about before. Because if you have interconnections in place, you want to be able to rely on them. And you can rely on them if sufficient sufficient capacity is being made available for that trade. Conversely, if you have an interconnector and there is not any capacity being made available for trade, what is the use of the interconnector? So these things do go hand in hand. And the second part, albeit less politically sexy, perhaps a bit more technical, there we have a strong role. And this we're going to up the ante big time in the coming years on this one, because it's a quid pro quo for the first one, which grabs most of the political headlines.
Muy bien, muchísimas gracias, Christian. Muchísimas gracias, Cani. Gracias a todos por vuestra asistencia, también a los que se han conectado online. Yo creo que hemos tenido una fantástica sesión. Nos ha permitido repasar todos los retos a los que se enfrenta la industria. No puedo más que concluir la importancia de que entre los políticos, los reguladores y los agentes en la industria acertemos en las medidas de regulación, porque esta transición hacia la energía sostenible nos jugamos mucho en ella, en esta transición. Es un tema complejo, es un tema difícil. Y la sociedad, si esto no sale bien, no lo va a entender y puede producir además un backlash, puede producir, puede agravar lo que a veces ocurre en nuestras sociedades occidentales, que es el sentimiento por parte de la población de que las decisiones de política pública pues están alejadas del día a día de los ciudadanos y les acaban perjudicando. Por tanto, es crucial que acertemos en las medidas correctas para que esa transición nos permita, sea exitosa y nos permita tener seguridad de suministro, resilience, y se haga con unos costes razonables. Con esto concluimos. Muchísimas gracias a todos. Gracias.